How do we decide who we want to be?
Who are you, Jack Frost? What is your center?
My center?
That is a beautiful concept, and that is pretty damn good therapy, Santa. Jack right now doesn't know what his purpose is. In fact, he feels like he was put here for a purpose, but it hasn't been communicated to him.
Right.
And I feel like that's true for a lot of people. Like, why am I here? What am I supposed to be doing? Part of understanding who your identity is understanding who you're not. He's not a superhero. He's just some kid who really,
really, really sounds like a 45-year-old man.
Jack, what have you done?
This can be a lifelong thing.
I know plenty of people who are still going through that in their 30s, 40s.
It's about figuring out, who am I, right? And what
are my core beliefs? What do I value?
It is my center. What is yours?
Hello and welcome to... Ooh, a little shimmy shake. Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist, and I love movies. This is...
Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker who needs therapy. And I just had to get comfy in my seat.
Gotta get cozy. Cozy on up with a mug of hot cocoa, because we're going to...
Polar Express?
No. Rise of the Guardians. We're going to do a Psychology of a Hero. For Jack Frost, our Psychology of a Hero series helps us to explore that our heroes wrestle with the same issues as all of us. Identity formation, isolation, role confusion, who are we, and where are we going, and why are we here? So, for those of you who haven't seen, this is kind of like the Avengers of holiday. It's like holiday...
It's the... Listen, it doesn't make any sense. Don't try to apply any logic to it. It's silly fun.
It is silly fun. But Jack Frost wakes up in the ice, and he comes out, and he doesn't remember his name. He doesn't remember where he came from, but the man in the moon tells him, your name is Jack Frost, and you can summon wind and cause flurries. Go to and flurried up. He doesn't know what he's here for, what his purpose is. So today we're going to talk about Eric Erickson's.
Eric Erickson.
It's like Philip Phillips.
We'll put a call into Aaron A. Aronson, shall we?
Please, don't be childish.
Eric and Joan Erickson were a psychiatrist and an educator, respectively.
Okay.
Who explored how we come to decide who we are going to be and what we're going to do with our lives.
All right.
And they have 8 stages, later revised to 9. And the Erickson's work has been foundational for the field of psychology in a lot of ways, especially developmental psychology of kids and adolescents.
And largely through observation, you know, proven accurate over, this is like... Been a while, right?
Yeah,
like
there's
50,
been
60 years.
Well, and the ones that are most supported are the ones that we're going to cover today.
Okay,
So role confusion versus identity, right? What am I supposed to do with my life versus I know who I am?
Mm-hmm.
And then isolation versus intimacy. So we're going to look at how do we get there in our own lives? How do we decide who we want to be?
Mom, so
been around for 100 plus years. Nobody can see him.
Frost nipping at your nose. Who's Jack Frost?
No one, honey. It's just an expression.
Hey!
Yeah. Whoa. Who's Jack Frost?
So why turn it into an ice ball? That's gonna do some damage.
Yeah.
Like, just throw the snow.
Okay, who threw that?
Well, it wasn't Bigfoot, kiddo.
So there's some delightful stuff in this movie.
You struck first.
Chris Pine was miscast. I'm gonna say it.
Why, because he's a man-child now?
We'll get into it.
I liked him, but I'm anxious to hear your thoughts. I like that he... Oh, yeah, this girl.
This is so great.
Red, I hit cupcake.
She hit cupcake.
You hit cupcake.
Hiding under the sled.
Oh.
Did you throw that?
No.
Wasn't me.
Kind of scary, actually.
Oh my gosh. The scariest part is the fake laughing.
Hers?
Everyone's. Everyone has to laugh so much in this movie, and they're just not succeeding.
Keep up with me, kid! Take a laugh!
Hey, slow down!
I like that he causes mischief, but he loves the kids that he interacts with, but they don't interact with him.
Oh, so for sure, yeah.
So it's at once sweet and sad. And I think the film nails that dynamic really well.
Yep.
He's very lonely. He wants to connect. Same time he can't. So he just vicariously lives through the fun of these other kids.
Yeah!
What, Jamie, are you all right?
Whoa! Did you guys see that? It was amazing!
amazing. I did the jump in and I slid under.
Oh. Because it's a kid's film, he survived that.
Cool, a tooth.
Not pictured the thousands of injuries requiring hospitalization a year from sledding.
Wait a minute, come on, hold on. What about all the fun we just had? That wasn't the tooth fairy, that was me. What's the guy gotta do to get a little attention around here?
I do love his flying animation. Like, the way the animators have him zipping around through the world is just phenomenal.
Well, and it's cool, like, that because he's Jack Frost nipping at your nose, it's wind. Like, he summons a chilly breeze. It's not him flying as much as being carried.
It's him being picked up and carried around, and he's learned how to control it and stuff. It's super fun. There's a lot of things I really loved about this movie. Chris Pine being miscast. Shall we?
What is that even like?
I'm going to disagree, but I want to hear your argument first.
So,
before I disagree with it categorically, out of hand.
You're wrong. So, Chris Pine is great. Everyone loves Chris Pine.
Yeah. Especially Gal Gadot.
This is a superhero film. We've all seen a bunch of superheroes.
Even as a younger man, bit gravelly voice, a little bit lower.
Yeah.
He looks like a 12-year-old, and he sounds like me right now. Hey, kid, what are you doing? Like, come on. It's just not the right voice coming out of the character's mouth.
It's perfect for the prince in Into the Woods that he plays.
Absolutely nails it. You know? Yeah.
I don't disagree on any particular point. I just think he's a great actor, and so I am emotionally invested in the character and the performance.
He gives it the best he could.
Who would you have put in his place then?
Elijah Wood, hands down.
I'm Wirt. I'm just a guy, I guess.
Same exact design, Elijah Wood's voice coming out of that face.
Yeah. Well, especially because he's supposed to be a teenager who's finding his way, and he sounds like, I can see that.
Yeah. Thank you, Raycon, for sponsoring this episode.
Their wireless earbuds, headphones, and speakers offer premium sound, useful features, an almost custom comfortable fit, and up to 54 hours of battery life.
I work from home, so the noise isolation mode is really helpful when I'm trying to block out background noise, like kids and dogs that sound like kids and dogs.
But you can also use them in awareness mode too, like when I listen to music or podcasts when I'm out jogging, but I also want to be able to hear what's going on around me.
So you don't get hit by a car or attacked by a group of vicious possums?
Yes, a pack.
A pack. What is a group of possums called?
I think it's a pack of possums.
Pack of possums?
Yeah.
Just hold the R button for 3 seconds to switch to possum mode. I mean awareness mode.
And you can control other things with the touch features on the earbuds, like adjust the volume, skip to the next song, answer or end calls, which is really helpful for me when I'm talking with clients.
They've got holiday gift guides for everyone in your life, or get 30% off by shopping Raycon's holiday bundles.
It's so tiny, it fits in my pocket without being encumbering.
Right? It's really nice.
And they've got several colors to choose from, so go pick out your favorite color and start listening to things better.
Click the link in the description box or go to buyraycon.com/cinematherapy to get 20% off site-wide. Or save even bigger and get 30% off Raycon's exclusive holiday bundles. There will also be different deals coming throughout the season, and we'll try to keep the description box updated with the latest offers. But just so you know, you can always go to buyraycon.com/cinematherapy to get the best deals available on Raycon.
Raycon, listen to things better. We did it for you. We wrote you a new thing.
They really won't fall out. Jack right now doesn't know what his purpose is. In fact, he feels like he was put here for a purpose, but it hasn't been communicated to him.
Right.
And I feel like that's true for a lot of people, especially those who seek a connection with the divine. Like, why am I here? What am I supposed to be doing?
Yeah, the man in the moon, really poor management style.
Yeah. But Jack doesn't know what his purpose is, and he's not even really seeking it.
No.
He's literally going through, I'm just going to cause mischief and have fun. But I like that it's a benign mischief.
Oh, yeah.
There's mischief where you are intending to harm, and then there's what he's doing, which is I just want everyone to have a good time.
Now we get down to tacks of breath.
I, to an unhealthy degree, love that he has naughty and nice tattoos on his arms.
What is your center?
My center?
If man and moon chose you to be a guardian, you must have something very special inside. Here, this is how you see me, no? Very big, intimidating. But if you get to know me a little, well, go on.
You are downright jolly.
But not just jolly. I am also mysterious. And fearless.
And
caring, and at my center,
there's a tiny wooden baby.
Look closer.
You have big eyes.
Yes, big eyes, very big, because they are full of wonder. That is my center. It is what I was born with, eyes that have always seen the wonder in everything. Eyes that see lights in the trees and magic in the air. This wonder is what I put into the world and what I protect in children. It is what makes me a guardian. It is my center. What is yours?
I don't know.
That is a beautiful concept, and that is pretty damn good therapy, Santa. That is a conversation I could have someone in therapy of what is your center? You know, what is it that makes you you, that makes you unique? The Erickson's talked about identity versus role confusion, that when you go from childhood and then you start going into adolescence, you're heading towards adulthood. Mm-hmm. And it's not so much about figuring out a career path per se. It's about figuring out who am I, right? And what
are my core beliefs? What do I value? Yeah. What do I not worry about?
Like my career path was 15 years ago was not, I'm going to end up on YouTube talking about movies with my buddy. My career path was, I'm going to be a therapist. Why? Because my center is helping people, right? That's something that I inherited specifically from my mom. That to me is a meaningful life. That's what brings me joy.
Right.
You know, for you, you're a creator.
Yeah.
At least that's my read on you, is that's your center.
Listen, I make movies, I make kids.
You didn't really do the making of the kids.
That was a pretty necessary part of the process.
You brought some ingredients over.
I did nothing. I did. I could be replaced with a syringe.
Oh my gosh.
We don't need you. What?
But the Erickson's would say that during this stage, you try on different hats, right? And I did this in middle school. I hung out with various social groups trying to see where I fit in. And you take on different jobs. Or when we got into college, like, I switched majors 3 times.
I did 5.
Yeah, you switched majors 5 times.
5 times.
Just trying to find what is my path and who am I? What do I believe? What are my values? What is my purpose? And the thing that the Erickson's were off on was they put a timeline on it.
Yeah.
This can be a lifelong thing.
I know plenty of people who are still going through that in their 30s, 40s.
Well, and sometimes it comes in phases, you know? Like, you had who you were in your 20s, and maybe by the time you're in your 40s, you've evolved into something else. But the important thing is that you are looking, and that you are trying things out, and that you are experimenting. So Jack, who's just been Jack Frost causing mischief, has now been recruited to be one of the guardians to protect children throughout the world, and he's not really keen on the gig.
It's just the weirdest superhero team-up ever. I just don't get it. Russian Santa, angry Australian Easter Bunny.
Voiced by Hugh Jackman.
Oh, such good casting. This is, okay. Chris Pine, I believe, miscast. Everyone else, flawless.
Alec Baldwin's great as Santa.
Alec Baldwin is amazing. Hugh Jackman is great. Isla Fisher crushes it. Mm-hmm. The guy voicing Sandman. Ah,
perfect. Jude Law as Jude pitch, Law, basically the boogeyman.
Listen, Jude Law suffers from Brad Pitt disease, where he's too pretty to be a character actor, but he's a brilliant character actor. Yeah. I want Jude Law in every movie, playing some weirdo.
Yeah, yeah, playing some weirdo. That's what he does. It's like when Brad Pitt did 12 Monkeys, and everyone's like, oh.
Oh, he's really great.
Yeah.
Let him play weirdos more. Pretty people can be weird. Look at him.
I'm actually just very touched.
See? It's getting weirder.
I thought this might happen. I never really believed in you. I was just trying to show you that. But I understand.
You don't understand anything! No! I don't know what it's like to be cast out!
I dig the sound design on this.
Oh, it's great.
To not be believed in! To long for a family!
All those years in the shadows, I thought no one else knows what this feels like. But now I see I was wrong. We don't have to be alone, Jack. I believe in you.
I would pay good money to see a movie that's like a... spy thriller duel of wits between Jude Law and actors, Chris Pine. That would be a hell of a movie.
Cold and dark.
What goes together better than cold and dark?
We'll give them a world where everything is
pitch black.
And Jack Frost, too.
They'll believe in both of us.
No, they'll fear both of us. And that's not what I want.
In the Erickson stages of development, we talk about role confusion versus identity, and then we follow that up with intimacy versus isolation.
Right.
And Pitch, as in Pitch Black or the Boogeyman, is offering Jack something he's never had, which is a place to belong.
Right.
Someone who understands him. I mean, he's the Guardians try to recruit him, but they don't really understand him. And with the exception of Santa...
They're kind of just telling him, hey, do this because it's what you're supposed to do, not like listening to him and like, hey, maybe you belong this way or this, you know.
And the Easter Bunny is openly antagonistic towards him. You know,
Easter Bunny's such a jerk. I love that character.
The Boogeyman understands him.
Yeah.
You're there, people don't see you. They don't believe in you. You don't feel loved. You don't feel welcome. Well, I guess Boogeyman doesn't care about feeling loved, but he used to wreak havoc through fear, and then people stopped believing in him.
Right.
And he's trying to get it back. And what I love about this is he's offering Jack everything he ever wanted, but at what cost?
Mm.
The cost is I instill fear in children, and that's not who I am.
Right.
Part of role formation, part of understanding who your identity is understanding who you're not.
Right.
And this is a great little moment of clarity for Jack here, is in figuring out what he's not, he starts to lean further into what he is.
Mm-hmm.
He is a guardian. He is someone who looks out for and cares for and loves children. When I was on my path to becoming a therapist, I started with what I wasn't. People ask you, why are you a therapist? And I said, because I would suck as an attorney. I would suck as a doctor. I would suck as an accountant. Like, I list all the things that I would be terrible at or that I might be good at, but I'd be miserable doing. And I became a therapist because I'm good at it, but also I love it.
Very similar journey for me, working in film and specifically being a director. I, you know, 5 majors in college.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, I would have been terrible at all of them. Like, any of those, like, me as an accountant, like, you do not want me keeping your books. I was sculpted, not built, if that makes sense.
Mm.
There was a big pile of rock and you had to cut in to, like, I had to cut in to find myself.
Stuff,
there were a lot of cuts. It wasn't like me walking up to a big stack of wood and going, I want to build this thing.
Yeah.
It was very much chipping away at everything else and finding...
your center.
Finding the Michelangelo inside.
Oh, wow.
It's okay. It's okay. Don't look down. Just look at me.
Jack, I'm scared.
I know. But you're gonna be all right. You're not gonna fall in. We're gonna have a little fun instead.
No, we're not.
Would I trick you?
Yes, you always play tricks.
All right, well, not this time. I promise, you're gonna be fine. You have to believe in me. You wanna play a game? We're gonna play hopscotch, like we play every day. It's as easy as, one. Whoa! Two. Three. All right. Now it's your turn.
And then he drowns in the ice water in this family film. But I do like in this memory, he sees who he really is. You know, he protected his sister, but he also comforted her and helped her find her courage.
That's why you chose
Again,
me.
Again, great performance from Chris Pine. It's just the wrong voice coming out of that.
That face. I am a guardian.
If they had digitally upped his voice an octave when he was mortal and had him sound more like a young teenager.
Because, yeah, I mean, he's been around for 300 years.
Right.
You can play that and have it make sense.
Because he's not a guardian there. He's not a superhero. He's just some kid who really...
really, really sounds like a 45-year-old man.
You bring us down a whole octave.
In a good way.
Okay, look. You and I are obviously at what they call a crossroads.
So this is the last boy who believes in the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny.
Then you have to prove it. Like, right now.
And if he stops believing, they're completely out of power, and the boogeyman can wreak havoc upon the Earth.
Because reasons.
Hey, it works for me.
I've believed in you for a long time, okay? Like, my whole life, in fact. So you kind of owe me now. You don't have to do much. Just a little sign, so I know.
All of the kids have such huge eyes in this film. Yeah. But it really works, like, for the emotional expression.
Uh-oh.
So, looking at Jack, intimacy versus isolation, he's not even getting the kid to believe in Jack Frost. He's getting him to believe in the Easter Bunny, who was kind of his enemy.
Right. Again, huge jerk the whole film.
But he, when it comes to intimacy, he understands a bit more about why the Easter Bunny is such a grouch and has come to care about him.
Yeah.
And the Easter Bunny told him earlier, nobody believes in you, and so it's beautiful that he's actually helping someone believe in the Easter Bunny now.
That's right.
Jack Frost.
Rainbow Quest 9 was great, but Rainbow Quest 7's really the OG. That's the good one.
You said...
I'm referring to a random poster on the kid's wall. I don't know why I'm talking about this.
That's right! But that's me! Jack Frost! That's my name! You said my name! Wait, can you hear me? Can you see me? He sees me! He sees me!
You just made it snow!
I know!
In my room!
I know!
You're real?
Yeah, man. Who do you think brings you all the blizzards and the snow days? And you remember when you went flying on that sled the other day?
That was you?
That was me!
Cool!
Right?
But what about the Easter Bunny and the Tooth Fairy? Like, I mean, what
real,
about...
Real, real, real. Every one of us is real.
I knew it!
Jamie, who are you talking to?
Jack Frost?
Okay.
That is totally what I would say, too.
Okay. Go back to sleep.
So, as Jack starts to, here's what I'm not someone who hurts kids or makes them afraid. Here's what I am. I'm a guardian. I'm a protector. Yep. He starts to figure out what his role is and who he is. According to the Erickson's, he'd then be ready to proceed to the next stage, which is this sense of community, this sense of intimacy. Now, I don't think that it goes sequential like that necessarily.
Right.
I think they all kind of bleed together and one can come before the other, but it is laid out nice and neat here. What I really want to pick your brain about is, you know who else can create snow out of nothing?
Me?
Not you, Elsa. And people are shipping Jack and Elsa hard.
Why?
What are your thoughts on this?
My thoughts on people shipping Jack and Elsa. Okay.
They're perfect for each other because she makes snow, he makes snow. It's perfect.
That's stupid. You're all dumb. Listen, I am very tall. I am 6'5", or 196 centimeters if you use, you know, a good measuring system. My whole life being single, people would try to set me up with people that I was perfect for. Oh, I know the perfect woman for you. She's great. You guys are going to get along great.
Based on?
She was tall. That's it. Elsa and Jack Frost would hate each other. First of all, pretty sure Elsa is either bi or ace.
You have a fulfilling heterosexual marriage at the age of 18, and I've just spent two whole movies playing with snow. Both are equal and good.
She's gay or she's bi or she's ace, but yeah.
There's some pretty decently strong ace coding in there. Beyond that, I mean, because that's not in the text, that's just subtext. In the text, she likes just being insular in a little group, and Jack Frost is a super outgoing, he's like an ultra extroverted guy. I mean,
maybe... And he's all about fun and she's all about order?
Maybe he's like her manic pixie dream icicle?
Dreamsicle.
Oh dear lord. He's her manic pixie dreamsicle. Okay, you sold me on it. Thanks, internet. We solved it.
Well,
we figured it out.
Opposites could attract and maybe they help each other grow, but here's the thing. if you think Jack and Elsa belong together, you're going to have to mount a convincing argument below.
In the comments.
And it can't be that they both make snow. It just can't.
Look, pick a trait and matching trait. That's not it, you dummies.
Please don't insult our fans.
That's not it, you wonderful people.
I can't tell you how happy it makes me to see you all like this. You look awful.
Jack, I'm scared. Jack, I'm scared.
I know. But you're gonna be all right. We're gonna have a little fun instead. That's it. That's my center.
So what do you think, Jamie? Do you believe in the boogie?
I hadn't really noticed the horses looking at each other like, what's this?
First of all, before we go thematically, I want to talk about the animation of the characters, specifically the coloring of the different characters.
Yeah, I mean, there's really strong color differences between each of the characters. It's you know, it's trying to make it very comic booky.
Yeah. Right?
So each one has their sort of primary color pop.
Well, I mean, Jack looks like he's frozen. Like, there's not a lot of color to him.
Yeah.
And Pitch looks like he's come from, like, some dour black and white nightmare. Like, oh, yeah. Like a horror film.
No, I do wonder if they just took all the color out of him.
Yeah.
Like, if they animated him one way and then just, like, took the slider and just went desat, Bert.
Yeah, because that's what he looks like.
That's what it looks like.
And so it's really cool to see them all on screen together. But Jack, he's now fully formed his identity. My center is fun.
Yeah.
Which is a pretty awesome center to have, by the way.
It's his.
Well, but it's true. I mean, when you say it's mine, because I tried to be a therapist and act how I thought therapists should act.
And you weren't very good at it.
It was, like, I was well-trained.
You're okay.
But it was when I brought my center to it that the power came out. I used to think, well, therapists dress a certain way and their offices look a certain way, so I need to get rid of all my geek stuff. And when I started to bring it back in, like my Yoda gumball machine and like my Superman thing that I have standing up in my office, and I started to just be me, I realized I started to attract the people that I was the best fit to work with anyways.
Right.
We sometimes get trapped as we try on different roles into how we should do this role. But what makes you you, what makes you unique, and what makes you a special gift to the world is your you-ness.
You-ness, Howard. Eunice.
It's whatever your center is. It's whatever. This is why when you talk about I'm never going to be Spielberg, and our fans like, but Alan, you're doing something that has mattered more to us than Spielberg.
And I'm almost ready to accept that. Almost. Look, I still need therapy. What can I say? If I stop needing therapy, we don't have a show.
Whoa.
You want me broken and damaged.
No, we'll find a new intro for you. We can still do the show.
Oh.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Yes. Give yourself permission to heal. Don't you need to?
I've been suffering for you, and it was all for naught.
I'm Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker, and therapy helped me. Like, there's our intro. Get better, man. For heaven's sakes.
Now I feel stupid.
Well, then I've done my job. What do you think your center is, if you had to say something today and commit to it forever and never change it?
Oh, well, something easy like that. My center is rampant libido and constant self-loathing.
You would have been Freud's favorite patient.
Right? I think my center is storytelling. In times in my life where I haven't been healthy, that has come out as lying.
But you're telling stories.
Not great, but I was really good at telling them. It's a big part of who I am.
All of you, what is your center? We want to know who you are. We want to read about it.
What makes you you? What is your Eunice?
Eunice. That's a person named Eunice.
Let us know in the comments below. So until next time, am I on the naughty list?
Naughty list? You hold the record.
And
watch movies.
Watch the movies.
Watch movies.
We want to thank our Patreon patrons who have helped us to provide this episode, especially
Johnny, Adam Howie, Danielle T, Jess, and Steely Dan Rather, my third favorite band of all time.
Thank you for supporting us on our Patreon.
You guys are the best patrons.